Good afternoon. Welcome to Arts, Culture, and Things in Between. I'm your host, Rose October. Thank you for joining again. As customary, I tell you a little bit about the program so that those of you who are new understand the concept. Arts, Culture, and Things in Between is a program that features individuals who are gatekeepers of our arts and culture. They're not only performing artists, but also teachers, advocates, and scholars who focus on the preservation of the arts and culture. When arts is mentioned, it is being referred to as different art forms. For example, visual arts, applied arts, and performing arts. Examples of visual arts would include painting, sculpture, photography, and film. Examples of applied arts would be architecture, as in designing and or building or constructing a project. How about fashion design, working with different types of patterns and fabrics? Jewelry design, working with materials such as wood, plastic, metal, silver, and gold. Also working with various types of stones. Furniture design, working with various types of woods and the ways that the woods are cut and designed. Performing arts now has to do with music, photography, film, theater, opera, drama, singing, stand-up comedy, and of course, my passion, dance. The middle part of the program's name, culture, as in arts, culture, and things in between, when culture is mentioned, it generally means the way of life for a particular group of people. So for this program, it is inclusive to mean the various groups of individuals that embrace ways of life. In other words, looking at attitudes and behaviors. What is important to note is that as culture is mentioned, I'm really looking at how practices are passed from one generation to another. Things in between. The last part of the name of the program, Arts, Culture, and Things in Between. This has to do with life's issues that affect the execution of the arts and cultural practices. This involves both positive and negative experiences that become part of the creative process. Today's guest is a performing artist. Let me share the bio. Yasho Comedy Sunarine, percussionist, instrumentalist, musician, answers to her fond name Yash. She is the offspring of Guyanese parents who've kept her grounded in exploring and learning about Guyanese and Caribbean culture. At 4 years old, Yash was presented with her first instrument, the tabla. 5 years later, she started taking tabla lessons at the East Indian Music Academy, where history began, and she was the first girl to graduate as a tabla player there. She continues to make history. Yash is actively involved in the Indo-Caribbean community in Queens, New York, where she passionately volunteers in various capacities. For many years, she has volunteered as a stage crew member for shows at the Nirvana Humanitarian Foundation and as a lecturer at the Arya Spiritual Center, her temple, where as a camp leader for 3 years, she lectured about being a female drummer. Yash considers herself a percussionist and plays instruments such as the Majira, bells, and the kabasa. As a percussionist playing these instruments, She focuses on enriching the music and performances. Although she considers herself a percussionist, Yash is super comfortable playing the drums. In addition to playing the tabla, for which she was professionally taught and trained, as mentioned before, she plays five other drums, which were self-taught. These drums are so much. 4 years ago, the drum pads or electric drums, 20 years ago, the dumbek, 13 years ago, the dafli, 5 years ago, and the udongo, which she only began playing last year. Yash is an accomplished tabla player who's performed international and nationally. Internationally, she has performed in Barbados, Canada, and Guyana. Nationally, she has performed in the New York tri-state areas, including Brooklyn, Queens, Manhattan, and New Jersey. She was showcased as a drummer in the show Little Angels, hosted by the renowned Angels Caribbean Band. For 8 years, she has performed as a drummer for the annual Sangeet Sabha at Queens College in Queens, New York. This annual concert was hosted by the East Indian Music Academy. Yash takes pride in acknowledging that for her last Sangeet Sabha performance, she was the only female performing and the only female playing the tabla solo. Additionally, she's also done multiple performances for the Guyana Day celebrations in the presence of the Consul General of Guyana, the Honorable Barbara Ashley, and the Guyana's Ambassador to the United Nations, the Honorable Rudolph Tenpal. Last year, Yash performed for the Valerie Rodway Centennial Concert that was hosted by the Guyana Cultural Association of New York. Most recently, in February of this year, she performed at the Guyana's Republic Jubilee Celebration held at the Metka Evers College. Yash is unique in the world of Indian classical music because of the rarity of being a female tabla player, and more importantly, a Caribbean female tabla player. Her crowning moment came some years ago when she performed a drum duet at a private concert in New Jersey with drums Sivamani, the world famous Indian percussionist from the Oscar award winning music team of Slam Dog Millionaire. Together, they performed Churalia, an old Bollywood song. So I've shared with you some highlights of my guest's work. So now I would like to share a slideshow and clip so that we can meet my guest today, Yasho Kamani Sunarine, the percussionist, instrumentalist, and musician. Let's watch. Oh, So here we are. Yash, welcome to Arts, Culture, and Things in Between.
Welcome to the Verizon commercial.
Welcome, Yash.
Thank you for having me.
You're welcome. So nice to see you.
Same here.
So we just watched a snapshot pretty much of your journey as a percussionist and musician.
And what, yes.
You know, what comes to mind when you watch?
That was like going down memory lane and to see how far I've come as a musician.
I was tickled at the baby picture. Oh, the, yeah. Oh, God. I thought that was awesome.
Yeah, I didn't know what I was doing. I just had two sticks and I was banging the tasa. And my dad was cheering me on, so I just kept going.
Okay, that was a tasa.
No. Yeah.
So you actually had some experience with the tasa as a child, as a babe.
Yes.
Do you remember how old you were there?
With the tasa, I was probably about 1 or 2 years old.
Wow.
Yeah, probably more too, because I was a little taller then. Yeah.
So one of the things that is mentioned in your bio is that you had your first gift or your first instrument at 4 years old that made a significant difference in your life. And that was the tabla. The tabla you remembered at 4 years old.
Yes, I actually got it for Christmas.
So let me ask you, you got a tabla at 4 years old. Not it around Christmas. Was it a toy tabla? And I don't mean to sound funny, but I just needed to.
No, definitely was not a toy tabla because I was smaller than the tabla. So I had to like sit on like a couple books just to be able to sit and play.
I mean, at 4 years old, you got a tabla. Do you remember what you were doing with this tabla? What you were supposed to do?
Well, I just hit it, you know, randomly to hear the sound that came out.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, who would have thought that it was the beginning of something grand?
I know. I didn't think so either.
So let's look a little forward now. You started with the tabla at 4 years old. Mm-hmm. Early on, then the tabla at 4 years old. As you got older and in retrospect, I'm wondering if you were aware of what your parents wanted for you at that age, looking back.
I think my parents encouraged me, you know, to do whatever it was that I wanted to pursue, and they supported me throughout, you know, my journey, including the fact that, you know, they presented me with a tabla at 4 years old. They saw that I was attracted to the tabla after we had a recording at our house for our temple. And when the musicians took a break, I just got up and sat down behind the tabla and tried to mimic what the tabla player was doing. And, you know, I guess the artists who saw me playing the tabla said, okay, you know, she has some rhythm in her, you know, get her a tabla. And that's how come we ended up getting a tabla for Christmas.
Wow. Do you know who that musician is?
I can't remember.
You got to ask your dad that. That would be good information to get. You know what's funny with what you're saying, though, Yash?
Mm-hmm.
Impressionable children are. You know, how a lot of, sometimes you find adults do not pay attention to what they're doing in the presence of children. And children are the best imitators. Here you were as a child, right?
Mm-hmm.
Your fourth birthday, your fourth Christmas celebration. and you're imitating, I'm sure, talented musicians. So much so that someone of those musicians took notice and said, got some rhythm. We need to do something about that. Get that child a tabla. And you got your tabla that was not a toy tabla.
Right.
So I know that another story about your earlier days with a tabla and preservation of your culture. And this might have happened in elementary school. There was a significant movement in elementary school. You want to talk about that?
So in elementary school, around fifth grade, I went to a Catholic school in Brooklyn. So I was, not really, there wasn't a lot of Indian children around me. I had two friends who were Indian who I grew close with as, I continued through the years. And I just decided one day, we wear uniforms to go to school. And we had to go to school during Diwali and Pagwa. So I went to my principal and I asked her if I can come out of uniform one day to express, my religion. Because in Catholic school, you taught religion in Catholic school. So I wanted to also express my religion and kind of see how it relates to Catholicism as well. So she agreed, and I had like cue cards. So I did like a whole science project type of vibe, and I went around to each classroom of children who could understand, at that age. And I think I went from like third grade all the way up to eighth grade, and I was telling them about my culture, and I had my two friends with me who helped with the presentation. And we all dressed up in our Indian outfits, shalwar, and just told them what Diwali was about.
How old were you at the time?
I was in fifth grade, so I can't remember how old that was.
You're beginning to sound like an old person, yeah. You can't remember.
Well, I was in fifth grade, and I kept doing it every year until about seventh grade. That's when I did something a little bit more elaborate. So I had my two friends that were with me through the grades. They have younger siblings, and there was also another Indian girl who was there. So we all got together and we performed a little cultural show at my school, and we had all the grades from I think first grade all the way to eighth grade. And the kids were just a year older than me. They all came down to the assembly room auditorium, and we put on a little show. So my two friends did a dance. I did a dance with them too. That was really out of my comfort zone. And I also did a little tabla demonstration. So afterwards, the next day, all the kids were coming around my desk and telling me, so now we know why you're always banging on the desk. Because you play the tabla. So I was like, okay, so now you got it. Now you can leave me alone.
So you mentioned something that I thought was ticklish to me. You actually danced.
Yes.
How was that for you? I mean, you said you were out of your comfort zone, but you danced.
Well, I'm very shy. So to do anything with movement and dancing, even singing, I just stay away from.
No. So was that the only time you danced?
Yes. Yeah, one of the only times. I think I danced one more time after that, but that was about it.
Now, all right. So let's put dance over here. Mm-hmm. From what you said, you would be tapping on the desk.
Yes.
Music. Were you aware that you were doing that?
No.
So it was a revelation when the children said to you, or when someone of the children said to you, oh, now we know why you're always banging on the desk.
I would get a lot of comments from the teacher to remind me to, you know, keep it down, or, you know, sometimes my friend sitting next to me would be like, stop that. And they'll give me like a little nudge.
Wow.
Yeah. And then I realized, snap back to reality or in school.
Let me ask you this though. Do you think that, and I'm leading you here because of my question. Were you ever nervous in class that you felt the need to stay in tabla mode, rhythm mode in your head, so much so that your fingers were always moving?
No, not at all. It was not like a nervous tick. It just became something natural after a while, you know, always wanting to improve myself. So I was always practicing either on my knees or on the desk, wiggling my fingers, something like that. It just became second nature. And sometimes I do it subconsciously.
So what is the weirdest piece of article that you've used to make rhythm when you don't have your tabla? I hear you on the desk, I hear you on your knees. Is there any point that you thought was, or any piece of material that you used on the tabla to make rhythm?
That I used on the tabla?
No, other than the tabla.
Oh, okay. Probably like spoons, utensils at a restaurant.
Uh-huh.
Hitting the table or the glass or the rim of the plate. I would get yelled at. You break it, you buy it.
What? I love it. So you were just making rhythms, period.
Yeah, everywhere I went.
Oh, my goodness. No, let me ask you this. We're talking about this now, right? And I don't know if you've had the opportunity to talk about it before. But I'm wondering, I am tickled. I'm tickled in a really good way. I want you to understand that, because sometimes our talent is nurtured a particular way and we're not paying attention as we go along the journey. So now we're sitting here and talking about this, and you have to reflect and really ask the questions that you didn't know that I was going to ask you.
Right.
Are you as tickled as I am when you look back at some of the ways that...
Oh, absolutely. I'm trying to hold in my lap right now because I mean, you don't think about it. All these things, you just go through life, and when someone asks you about it, you think about it. It's like, oh, I did some really weird things.
Yeah, but good weird things though, because look at you.
Yes, absolutely.
Wow, interesting stuff. I am so excited to have you, Yash. It's ridiculously amazing. Why don't we watch you on the tabla again and really see how some of what you've just described. All right, let's take a watch at what you're doing to develop your skills. Okay. Yash, those fingers, the heel of the hand. I mean, we have to talk about what's involved. So we just watched that clip with you practicing to play the tabla. But before we talk about your practice regimen of playing the tabla, I have a very touchy situation to talk to you about. And then we'll go, because I don't want to forget this piece of touchy information that I want us to discuss. I know that your name is very unique. I want to talk about your name, Yasha Comedy. And you're very particular in making sure that your name is pronounced well and properly and right and appropriately so. Now, Yasha Comedy, and I might be emphasizing your name in other places than you would when you are saying it. So one of the things I would like you to say is your name, and then tell us the meaning of your name, because I know when people call you other than your name, it has different meanings depending on how they struggle to say it. So let's talk about your name for a minute and how many times you had a teaching moment when you're talking to somebody who might have mispronounced your name. Let's talk about your name.
Okay, so I'll take you through from the very beginning. When I was born, the pundit usually has to open book, as they call it, and tell you what your name is supposed to start with. So my, depending on the time and day I was born, it had to be YA. So a lot of the YA names that you get is Yashoda or Yashomati, which is names that came from religious texts. And my parents, you know, didn't want those names because, you know, Guyanese have a way of saying the names and making it sound like something that it's not. So if you call me Yashoda, they're going to say Jasodra. And I guess they didn't want that. So between my father and the pundit, they came up with the name Yasho Comedy. So Yash means fame and Comedy means desire. So when you put it together, the whole name is one who will be famous or one who is desirous of fame. And a lot of people, when I was in school and growing up, even now as an adult, you know, they would get my name wrong and say Kamini. And Kamini in Hindi is usually meaning someone as a thief or a con person, or, you know, some people might call Kamine, meaning, you know, like it's like a bad word in Hindi. So I always emphasize to people that it's Kamini. So it's mini, like in Minnie Mouse, Kamini. And I would always teach people how to say my name. Most of the times they don't get it, but it's okay. So I just shorten it and say, you can call me Yash.
What are some names though that you've been called?
So Yesho Kamini. Yoshi, some people call me Yashi, and I just like, if you want to add an extra letter, you put the O instead of the I and you actually get my name, Yesho.
So it's important that your name is said correctly, because it not being said correctly could mean something very negative.
Yes. And it actually took me a little while to appreciate my name. Being when I was younger, you know, I didn't like people calling me Kamini, or I didn't like people calling me, you know, Yash. It was different phases in my life that I went through. And then getting to know myself as growing up, that's when, you know, I became a little bit more appreciative of my name. and proud to say my full name is Yashil Kamli whenever I introduce myself.
Yeah, you know, somebody. It's very exotic, I must say.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Some people, when they hear it, they ask me if it's Japanese, and I always just say, no, it's Hindi. I guess because of the ni at the end, maybe some people think it's Japanese, but it's Hindi. All the time, it's Hindi.
Yeah. So I didn't want to forget that piece about your name, because I should have asked you about it earlier. Let's go to the clip that we saw with you practicing the tabla, because that's actually what you call that clip.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Where you were when you were doing that?
So I was working at Sam Ash Music Store, and I was in the drum department. I was also one of the first females to be working in the drum department at Sam Ash. And one of the guys who were in the audio, visual, and sound, they like to, you know, make beats and stuff using Pro Tools. So he sent me the music in the background. He sent it to me, and he said, here, you know, drop some tabla on it and practice it or something. So I came home from a shift at Sam Ash. I played the track, and I was just, you know, playing along with the tabla. That video wasn't rehearsed or anything. It was just like a fresh take.
Wow.
Yeah.
I got a chance to really watch your hands at work. Now, I have a little drum education, a little, on the djembe drum. And I know, depending on where in the drum you hit, what part of the hands you use, you get a different sound.
Mm-hmm.
How similar is that with the tabla?
It's pretty much the same thing. The more outer you play, the lighter the sound, and when you play inner, it sounds a little bit more flat, less of a ring to it. So if I play outer, you hear the ring at the end, as opposed to when I play inner. It sounds a little flat.
What about using the heel of the hand?
So the heel of the hand is used to modulate the bass. So if I play the bass just like this, it rings out.
Uh-huh.
If I put I press on the heel, it gives, you know, different sounds to it, modulate the bass.
Okay. Wow. I'm so tempted to ask you to play something, but I'll wait. I will wait. Why don't we watch you again in one of your other pieces, just to show more development of your craft? So for those of you joining us, you're with us on Arts, Culture, and Things in Between, and my guest today is Yash Sunarine, who is a percussionist, instrumentalist, and musician. And her pet instrument is the tabla, amongst other things. So let's watch Yash at work.
Thank you.
All right, I was jamming.
Me too.
I was jamming. It's so sweet. Oh my goodness. It is so sweet. All right, so I have to ask you, looking back at that, aside from enjoying it, what were you thinking as you were watching? What were you thinking?
Well, like you always mentioning my fingers, so I was looking at my fingers basically and how I was playing the duffly with the flicks and everything. And I just remembered a story. Well, not a story, but something that happened when I was younger. I was getting out of the car and I was about maybe 5 years old. So I was still, you know, picking up a little bit more on the tabla. And my dad closed the door on my fingers. And he was just so apologetic afterwards because, well, it hurt. And he was just like, no, the tabla fingers, we can't do that. Put some ice on it. You know, I had everyone attending to me. Don't use the hand for like a whole week.
Wow. Oh, my goodness. The tabla fingers, we have to keep them. We have to care for them. So, yes. So we just watched you playing two six drums that you play. You played six drums. The tabla that you were professionally trained, taught on, which you're sitting behind, yes. And the five others, the dolak, the drum pads or the electric drums, the dumbek, the dafli, which you were playing just now with the dolak, and the udongo. So the tabla and the dafli were the two that you were playing.
Yes.
Notice that with the dafli, you're doing a lot of flicking of the fingers, and I don't know if I have the lingo right. Right. I don't know if I have the lingo right in saying that you were flipping, flipping your fingers.
Yes. Because it's like, you know, like you just flick your fingers in between your thumb and your, I use my middle finger, and you basically use the nail of your fingers to get the sound, the sharper sound, I should say.
Now, is it all of your fingers?
You can use all the fingers, or you can use two fingers, depending on what sound that you want.
And similarly, I'm thinking that depending on where you hit on the drum, you get different sounds.
Yes. So the outer side, the outer ring of the dafli is the lighter or more sharper sound, and then the middle is you get like the bass sound.
Okay. Now, is there any way that you can compare, let's say, the dumbek and the udongo? What does the dumbek look like?
The dumbek is like a round bowl that has a stem, I guess, coming out from it. So it's shaped like a Y,
okay,
a little rounded. It's basically a smaller version of a dumbek, which is the bigger African drum that they play.
Okay.
And similarly to the dafli, if you play on the outside of it, like at the end, you get a sharper sound, and then the middle, you get a bass sound. So you move your hand in and out to get the rhythm that you desire.
Now with the dafli, is it always mounted the way that you had it on the side?
No, you can play it in your hand. You can hold it and play it in your hand like that. Sometimes you can have it in your lap. Depends on what you desire. But because I was sitting, it just made it easier to mount it on there, and also basically for the camera to be able to see it.
So let me ask you this. If you're holding it up in your hand, like you just said, or you your lap, would the sounds be different? Although you're playing using the same techniques, would the sound be different depending on where you mount the drum?
A little bit. If you have it on your lap, it'll be a little bit more muted because there's no space for the sound to come out. Remember, the whole back of the drum is open. It's a round frame, a round wooden frame with the skin mounted onto it. So the sound needs to, come out towards the back. So if you have it in your hand, it's just your arm blocking it. But if it's down on your lap, you have a lot of area covering the back. So it'll sound a little muted, and you might not get the sharpest sound that you would be looking for.
Okay. Now, you have two other drums on your side, in addition to the dolak in front of you. What are those drums?
Well, these are the dolaks, and this is the tabla. So these are my two dolaks that I have.
Okay. And I take that they do the same thing?
Yes, they do the same thing. They sound the same.
Now, in terms of technique, in playing the dolak, how is that different or similar to playing the tabla?
So how I learned to play the dolak was I had learned finger placements on the tabla. So, your ring finger is here, you play with your index finger, your middle finger doesn't touch, different techniques like that. So I had turned my tabla sideways like this because that's how the dolak was.
Okay.
And I practiced the same principle with the, keeping the middle finger up, your right finger, your ring finger is mounted, the same thing with the bass side. And I kind of applied the same principle to the dolak. And eventually, with watching videos and seeing other people play, I kind of modified it to, make it sound a little bit more like a dolak as opposed to tabla.
So I want to ask you if you can give us a couple of something, I don't know what you call it, on the dolak. Because we've seen you play the tabla, but nothing on the dolak. So could you give us a rhythm, a thing?
Okay, so I'm going to need your help with this.
Okay, come on. Don't tell me that you want me to sing or anything because I'm not singing now.
Of course. Okay, you don't have to sing. Maybe chant.
Okay, what do you want me to chant?
You know the song, This Time, Not Long Time?
Oh, shoot. Yes. I know This Time, Not Long Time.
Okay, so just hum a little piece for me.
This time, not long time. This time, not long time. Love it, love it, love it. And you would have to pay me for accompanying you there.
Oh, of course, no problem.
Oh, man, that was so awesome. Thank you, thank you, thank you. This is really good. I'm going to stretch it a little bit. Do you have the udongo anywhere close by or no?
No, that's packed away.
At the dumbbell you don't have close by, but that's okay. That's okay. I'm just trying to, stretch it a little bit and push the envelope. I'm thankful for the dolak and the tabla right now, so you know.
I can play a little bit more on the dolak for you if you'd like.
All right, go ahead.
Okay. So in like the older times, if you see a lady playing a dolak, usually at weddings or stuff or things where men aren't usually around, so the old, I call it the old lady beat.
Okay.
Because this is how they used to play the dolak.
You mean the women?
Yeah, this is how the ladies used to play the dolak.
Now, how would the young ladies play the dolak?
So, if you're a young lady who play the dolak, like me, I guess, I would play something like this.
Nice. Got it. I got it. I'm not going to say anything about the young ladies nor the old ladies. I'm just going to stay neutral right now. Thank you, Yash. Thank you for that. For those of you joining us, you are here with me on Arts, Culture, and Things in Between. I'm sitting with my guest today, Yash Sunarayan, who is a percussionist, a instrumentalist, musician. We'll take a look at more of Yash's work. Let's look at Conversations Between Continents. I think that's what you call this clip that we're about to see, that we're about to watch. Let's watch Yash at work. Instrumentalist, the musician. What was that drum you were playing there?
That is a clay drum called the udongo.
That is the udongo.
Yes.
Now, you were playing there with a group of other young, gifted musicians.
Yes.
What was the occasion? Do you remember?
They were doing a fundraising concert at my temple.
Okay.
And asked me to perform. And the Christmas before is when I had acquired the udongo.
Okay.
So I wanted to compose a little, what we call a jugglebundi, between the udongo, which is from Africa, and the tabla, which is from the subcontinent, India.
Okay.
And that's one of the reasons why I named it Conversations Between Continents.
Got it. Okay. So you're lending some more color to this. So you're saying that the udongo has its roots in Africa.
Yes.
Any of the other drums that you play has roots in Africa?
The dumbek.
Dumbek. Mm-hmm. No. Between the dumbek and the udongo, are the techniques similar?
Not Quite. The udongo is a clay drum that has a hole in the middle on two sides. The way it's shaped gives it a more of like a metallic or a clay sound. It's a little sharper sound. And if you noticed in the video, I had tape around my fingers.
Yes.
That was also to create a different sound and a sharper sound from the udongo. And the hole in the middle, let's say, for example, this black spot here is empty. It's hollow. So I covered the hand over the hole to give it that bass sound. So it's played differently. So instead of in the dumbek, instead of hitting the middle to get the bass, here on the udongo, I cover the hole to get the bass. Just hit it like that.
So what I'm also hearing is that you're a composer too.
No. I just tried, you know, a little, just a little thing. Not completely.
Thing, you know, if you're bringing together the continents, you know, and you're working with different sounds and drums and rhythms, I'm hearing some composing in the mix here. I know you're too shy to embrace it, but I am hearing some composing. So we watched you there with a group of young, vibrant experts in the musical arena. And I know that because I've watched you all work together. I've had the so I want to ask you, as you look back on your journey, how old were you when you did your first performance?
My first performance was probably at home, which was, I was about 4, 5 years old.
Okay.
Say, there was a gentleman from our temple who came to do the roof at our house. And because I knew him from temple and I was familiar with him, I said, oh, sit down, let me play the tabla for you. And I sat, I played the tabla. At the end of the day, he gave me $20.
Wow. So that was your first paid performance.
Yes. First performance and first paid, yes.
Now, that must have been kind of exciting for a little kid, a little child, because, you know, obviously she's enjoying playing music. Yes. So much so, ask for an audience in an adult, got it, and then got some money for it. So you were off to a good start. More importantly, you've had the opportunity to perform internationally in Barbados, Canada, and Guyana.
Yes.
What stands out for you in any of those performances?
So I played, I went to Barbados to do a Diwali concert. They have a youth group down there in Barbados. And I played, I did a little solo. I had everything. I had a tabla, and I had borrowed a dholak from the temple to showcase, you know, the tabla and the dholak and what I can play. I also, you know, tried to do as many different things as I could between the tabla and dholak to showcase, as well as Canada. I played for private events, people's birthday. They had like a little mehfil, which is just a night of music, Indian music. And in Guyana, I actually played for a wedding, but the Guyana performance was unexpected. I was not prepared to play the tabla, but someone went and found a broken tabla. And this is how bad they wanted me to play. They found the broken tabla, put it on the stage and say, here, come play something for us. So I did. I played the broken tabla and it sounded great.
Wow. Now, I'm sure that must have been an outstanding memory for you, given that the tabla was broken and you didn't plan to play. Now...
Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off. I just remembered another detail. The tabla was broken and it was in the middle of a blackout. So there was no mics. There was no sound. So it was just all me.
Wow. Well, your skills were tested.
Yes.
I would say your skills were tested. Now, when you have traveled internationally and you've played, I'm wondering, given the uniqueness of being a female tabla player, if those who are grounded in the arts and culture would approach you and want to have discussions about you being a girl, you being a female playing the tabla.
So a lot of people, you know, have come to me after a performance and, you know, ask me where I started, which music school do I go to, and have conversations with me. Most of them are always pleasant. And after I performed one time at York College, the Honorable Rudolph Tenpao, the U.S. ambassador to Guyana, to the United Nations from Guyana, he asked me to come and play. He invited me to come and play at the United Nations. So that, I think, is still in the works. I'm not sure. But, you know, people have come to ask me to play at different temples or their functions or things like that. So it's always very warming and inviting.
Now, this is not meant to be a trick question. Mm-hmm. Do you get to a place whereby, or are you at the place right now whereby you don't need to learn anything else about the tabla?
No, I would know. I'm the type of person, I'm always learning, and I would always, you know, say that I need to learn more, or I need to do this. I still watch other people who have been playing tabla maybe less years than I have, and I learn something from them. Or even people older that I learn something from. I'm always learning from the tabla. I would never say that I've mastered any of the instruments that I play.
The reason I ask that is because there's some foundational knowledge that's needed. There's some foundational techniques that are needed for anything, right? And then you build on that. And that's where I was coming from when I ask. I mean, I don't know if there is any more teachings from, okay, so you went to the East Indian Music Academy and you learned how to play the tabla, and you graduated from there. Is there any place else that you can go to be formally taught more about the tabla? I guess that's what I'm trying to ask.
Yes, certain tabla players, like the ones from India, they come to New York or California. I know Zakir Hussain does a tabla workshop that you can attend to. I think it's for like about 2 weeks. You go and you play tabla 8 hours a day. It's, you know, very rigorous and very strict. I feel like I haven't been strong enough as a tabla player to go there just yet, but I think one day I will.
Interesting. So 8 hours a day for 2 weeks.
Yes. It's pretty rigorous. Because he requires, you know, a lot of stamina to be able to play for a long time without having your fingers hurting, or, you know, it's just more of a discipline that he's teaching you.
Now, I hear you about more of the discipline for 8 hours, but I'm also wondering what else, because if you're going to play for 8 hours, I'm thinking that there would be, the playing would be the practicum, but I'm also thinking there might be some theoretical aspects of playing the tabla that he might be covering.
Yes. So he shows you his techniques that he plays, as opposed to, you know, as a tabla player, when you play, you develop your own style. Mm-hmm. So if somebody closes their eyes and they're hearing me play tabla, they can tell, okay, this is Yesho playing tabla, or this is, you know, Zakir Hussain playing tabla. So when you go to him, you get to learn a little techniques of what he does, and you can in turn make it your own. you know, and just develop yourself further as a tabla player.
So let me ask you this. For example, the person that you just mentioned, what's his name?
Zakir Hussain.
Zakir Hussain. So there are some mini Zakir Husseins around New York because they've attended his workshops for 2 weeks, learned his techniques, gotten some theoretical knowledge, and are applying.
Yes. So my tabla coach that my first tabla teacher was Dr. Ravidin Ramsamuj. And then after, when I graduated from the East Indian Music Academy, I was under the tutelage of his son, Abhirod Sharma. Mm-hmm. Abhirod Sharma went to Zakir Hussain's workshop, and so he brought back all those teachings and has been teaching it to me as well and other students at the academy.
Got it. So then I understand now that I understand what you just mentioned in terms of room for growth, because if these, I'll use the word gurus, are coming and conducting workshops, it's another way to really broaden your horizon when it comes to your craft. Yeah. Now, aside from Mr. Hussain, who you just mentioned, is there anybody else that you know about who does intensive workshops with the tabla?
I think they have Pandit Anindo Chatterjee.
Okay.
He does workshops. I think there is other gurus, like you said, who have workshops. I can't recall all the names right now, but they also teach other instruments besides tabla. In different parts of India, like South India, they use the ghatam, which is a big clay pot that they play usually in South Indian, in South Indian music.
Okay. Now, are they based in New York or they're out of New York? Some of these gurus.
They're out of New York.
Okay.
Some are in New York and most of them are out of New York. They come to the States to do their workshops.
Okay. I just need to ask you a couple of questions before we look at some more of your work. Now, you refer to yourself as a percussionist, although you play drums. I thought that's something for us to really, really look into. Now, the percussions you play are the majira, the bells, and the kabasa.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us what the majira is, tell us what the bells are, and tell us what the kabasa is.
So the majira is, it's like a little finger cymbal. It's a little bigger than a finger cymbal, and it's has strings connecting the two. So you hold it side to side. You know the little monkey that goes around, you know, playing the cymbals. So it's basically like that, but you play it at different, you know, levels, and it accompanies the music, different styles of Indian music as well. And the bells, it's not really bells. It's more like chimes, like wind chimes. If you strike it with like your finger or a stick, you know, just to get that little sound effect at the beginning of a song, sometimes you'll hear it. And I have the kabasa here that you could also play just to give you a little bit of a rhythm.
Now, would one kabasa do the job in a piece? I mean, it seems like a small instrument, but impactful yet because of the unique sound.
Right. So some instruments or some percussionists, they use it, they can play it and then loop it, and then you can play the tabla over it. And in that case, the one of it would be, you know, good enough. And sometimes it doesn't always have to be mic'd up, just like how I have my tabla here in the mic. I play it and you can still, you know, you can still be able to hear the effect of it.
Okay. So this is a crazy question. Somebody else has to be playing that while you play the tabla. Am I correct?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Just wanted to make sure that, go ahead, you wanted to say.
If you loop it, then I could, you know, basically be a one woman band.
Okay. And
my singing and keyboard.
Looping means, explain that.
I'm sorry, I didn't catch that.
For those who don't know what looping means, explain that.
So just to play the same thing over and over and over again.
Okay.
So you put, if you do it one time, like, and then you do it again and again and again through like the mixer, or sometimes they have a little foot pedal that they use to cue the loop.
Okay.
So it makes it continuous so that you can play over.
Okay. Now, do you always see these instruments when a group is performing, or it depends on the genre?
Most of the time, yes. Sometimes you will have people have a dantal, which is like a long metal rod, and then they have like another rod that they hit together to play. Most of the times, it's usually the dantal or the majira that you hear with Indian music.
Okay. And not the bells?
It depends on how big of a orchestra, I guess you can say, that they have.
Okay. All right. Good stuff. Good stuff. Let's watch you at work again. This time is, anyways, let's just watch. Let's watch your development. I just love this. I am enjoying it. For those of you out there who found the time to sit with us, this is Rose October and Arts, Culture, and Things in Between. And I'm sitting with Yash Sunarayan, a percussionist, instrumentalist, and musician. Let's watch Yash's work.
जाऊंगा लुट करके तेरे बदन के डाले को लहू जिगर का दूंगा ऐसी लबों के डाले को जाऊंगा लुट करके तेरे बदन के डाले को लहू जिगर का दूंगा ऐसी लबों के डाले को ए बता इस जहाँ को एक दिन मैं दीवाना चुरा लिया है तुमने जो दिल को नजर नहीं चुराना सनम मेरी तुम जिंद कहानी बदल न जाना हरे कृष्ण Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare.
You're smiling.
Yes.
Why? You are smiling. Why?
Good memories.
So what we just saw there is what you consider the highlight of your career so far, right?
Yeah.
Because you got to work with drums Sivamani, who is the world famous Indian percussionist from the Oscar award winning music team of Slumdog Millionaire, right? So you were excited to do this.
Absolutely. Who wouldn't be?
Tell us, how did this come about?
So I went to India at 60. They Indie Tourism India at 50, sorry, had like a little show in South Street Seaport. So, you know, I went there a little early to watch the guy set up, and, you know, I was introduced to, I think that was the first time that I met Shivamani. And he, you know, my dad told him that I was a tabla player. He said, oh, okay, so, you know, I'm doing a concert at so-and-so time. Come jam with me. And I just looked at him like he had 50 heads. I was like, what are you talking about? Like, I'm not, you know, that good of a tabla player to go and jam with you. Like, you are so great. He was one of my biggest role models in music. And that's one of the reasons why, you know, I decided to pursue being a percussionist also. Because he plays almost every percussion you can think of.
Mm-hmm.
So we went to the concert, and I actually, before we went there, I asked my dad, I'm like, do you think he's serious? And he said, listen, if Shivamani tells you to bring your tabla and come play with him, you bring your tabla and you come play with him.
So listen, so your dad told him that you played the tabla, but how, I mean, your dad knew somebody, knew him, is that it? How was the connection? I mean,
they had worked together before, previously.
Okay, okay. Yeah.
So that's how come we knew that they were going to be there at that time. And I mean, it just happened out of the blue. It wasn't planned or anything besides him asking me to come and play. That was just something that came out of thin air. But I went and I played with him, and I had a different tabla at the time, an older tabla. And, you know, we were setting up and everything. I was tuning my tabla, and he was listening to the tabla. And after the show, he goes to my dad, what kind of tabla you have this girl playing? Like, she needs to get a proper professional tabla. And I ended up getting my second pair of tabla at that time afterwards, because he gave my dad a number of this tabla player in India that makes tablas that Zakir Hussain uses.
Okay.
So that's how I ended up getting that hookup. And after that, because I was so, you know, in love with him and his music and what he does, I invited him to my birthday.
Mm-hmm.
One of the birthdays, and I know it was a you know, small chance of him coming, because he's this big star traveling the world, touring, you know, doing performances all over. So he came, he did a little performance for my birthday, which I was very, you know, very much appreciative of. And next thing, maybe like a month or so later in the mail, that's when I got my Dumbek.
Wow. He sent it on?
He gave me my Dumbek as a birthday present.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
That is cool. That is super cool.
And not to mention, it was also in my favorite color.
What is?
Blue.
Oh, okay.
So I have this habit of naming my tablas because they are like my prized possession. So all my drums have names, well, most of them.
Okay.
Udongo still doesn't have a name yet, but I'm working on that one.
Which one doesn't have a name?
The Udongo.
So what is the name of your two tablas that you're sitting behind?
So this tabla is the Sonu tabla.
Okay.
It's named Sonu. I have two other tablas that I call Amrit and Amit. They all start with A.
Okay.
Except for this one, but there's a story behind this one. And the Dumbek I named Anand because Shivamani's name is Anandan Shivamani. Or is it Shivamani Anandan? One of the two.
Okay.
So I named that one Anand. And then I have my two Doleks here. The other one of my Dolek is Aryan. And another one is Akash.
Okay. Wow. You're
like A names for some reason.
Let me ask you this. You mentioned something that piqued my curiosity.
Yes.
You talked about old tabla. Now, are they modernizing tablas as we go along?
No, old meaning that it was one of the first tablas I had.
Right.
So they're different. All the tablas are constructed basically the same, but there's different grade levels. So the one that I had wasn't exactly a professional grade level tabla.
Mm-hmm.
So after, you know, we have the hookups to the tabla player in India, that one was a little bit more performance tabla. And the tabla, how you know the difference is that the shell, each tabla is made out of wood, and the shell is, you know, pretty heavy. And the heavier the shell, I guess, you know, it's how you know the quality.
What are you calling the shell?
The wood.
Okay.
The wood piece is the shell. And also the skin, also the quality of skin also makes a very big difference.
Now the other tabla, the one to your left, from where I sit, it does not look like wood. It looks shiny. Is it wood?
Oh, this one?
No, the one in front of you, your tabla I'm talking
about. This. This is metal.
It's metal?
Yeah, this one is made out of metal, and it's pretty round at the side here. So the rounder it is, the more bass and the more full, robust sound you get out of it.
All right, so then I need further clarification here. You're saying that, and this is for me and others to understand.
Mm-hmm.
So that they are usually different in size and shape? Is that yes or no?
Yes.
And the materials are usually different?
Between the two, the smaller side is the wood shell.
Uh-huh.
The larger side is usually the metal shell.
And that's usually how they are?
Yes.
And it's a pair?
Yes.
Okay.
The pair together is called a tabla.
Right. Okay. So let me ask you. Would it be... would it be weird to see a pair of wooden or a pair of metal tabla?
No.
Okay.
If you just say the tabla, they know that one side is the wooden and one side is the metal.
So it's always that way. Well, okay.
But some people are making the tabla with like fiberglass.
Uh-huh.
The strings here, it's not animal skin. They're making it out of nylon.
Right.
That's more for like, I think that's more for decorative and effects of making it look. But that's just my personal opinion. I've never actually played a tabla with the nylon string or the fiberglass body, so I don't know, you know, how the sound is. That's just, you know.
Similar with the djembe, I know that some parts of the world now are using the PVC. The PVC materials in place of the actual goat skin, because the how expensive it is, or the rarity of getting goat skins where they might be located. So that's why I'm asking. But more importantly, though, I never paid attention to the fact that one was wood and one was metal until this conversation. So I'm glad that we're really talking about this, and of course the top of the tabla would be constructed the same way for both.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So they have layers of skin, animal skin. I think it's deer skin.
Okay.
Might be different animals, but it's animal skin regardless, and it's like three layers. You have this layer, it's like, I don't know if you can see, but it's three.
Yeah, I can see.
Three layers. So the outer layer, then you have the inner layer, and then you have the black part here. And the black part is called the siyahi. And it's usually made from like metal filings.
Okay.
And it helps to give the ring or a sound of the tabla. So if I play a sound, it helps to have it sustain a little bit longer.
Okay.
Same thing for this side as well.
Okay. Okay. Got it. Got it. Got it. So I want to ask you now, after we've talked so much about the tabla, could you play something for us?
Sure. So like I was describing, because it's animal skin, usually tabla players put a little bit of powder on it because it's your skin rubbing on animal skin. So that friction can get a little hot. Uh-huh. So I'm going to put a little bit of powder on it to help with the friction. There is just a little variation of a tal called tintal, and tal means rhythm. So the tintal is da din din da da din din da da tin tin ta ta din din da. Those are the notes that I'm going to play.
So you took me back to my days of Kathak dancing. Oh my goodness, that sounded so nostalgic for me. Mm-hmm. If I were to ask you to play a juicy rhythm, and I don't know what that is, other than the tiltal, what would you play?
So you remember this time, the long time is... It's like a four beat cycle that we play. So that is din ta din ta din din. So it's four notes and you cycle it and you get the rhythm. And when you play it faster now,
you were now getting into the sweet part. But when you started playing, I have to tell you, I heard such comparisons to the African drums when you started playing before you increased the tempo, because you could have easily been playing the djembe.
Mm-hmm.
You could have easily been playing. Go ahead.
So it's the drumming all sounds similar. And the root of all the instruments, the African drum, the tabla, I feel like they all have the same like rhythm of it, and the same storytelling. So all the drums, you know, you can use to tell a story. So and also gives out emotion as well. So when you're telling a story, usually the drums help to carry the story along, and it makes you feel the emotions through the storytelling.
No. Do you write music?
No.
You don't? No. You do a lot of free flow, free jam, kind of.
Yes.
Especially when you get together with others. And it can, of course, it can be done when you're soloing because you're by yourself.
Right.
Have you ever discovered a rhythm or a technique while you're performing, while you're free flowing, and decided that it's something you want to embellish?
So one of the things that I did was try to take them through a story. So for one of the events that I performed solo was for the Guyana Republic Day. And I had people help me out as interactive. I had them do the cricket clap because, you know, for the cricket games. And then after they were doing that, I was freestyling on the tabla in that rhythm. Then I had them take them through the This Time the Long Time, the Mortor beat, which is a faster type of chutney beat.
What beat?
Mortor. That's the beat that I call it. It's the song is Mortor.
Okay.
Sang by Ricky Jai.
Okay. Mortor. Okay.
I took them through that so that they hear the beat, a different beat in every song. Even the Bunger beat I also did.
The what?
The Bunger beat.
So tell me, what is the cricket clap?
So the cricket clap is.
Okay.
And okay. Then you can do it at the cricket games when they happen.
So that also sounds like this song, Car Wash. That's what you're talking about. And what would you play? We did This Time in a Long Time.
Mm-hmm.
I want to hear Motor, but I don't know the music. I don't know the song, so I don't want to sound stupid.
That's okay. The Motor beat I can actually play on the Dolok for you. Okay,
good.
So this Dolok was custom made for me by Uncle Rudy. He was a very prominent Dolok player. He played for a lot of people with Tan singing and stuff. And he makes Doloks. So he measured my hand and he made this Dolok specifically for me. And this is one of the last Doloks I think he made before he passed away. So this Dolok is also very special to me.
Has sentimental value.
Yes. I don't let anybody play with it because, God forbid, it breaks. I don't have anyone to repair it.
I don't blame you. Now tell me, what's the Bunger beat?
The Bunger beat is like the Punjabi music. They played, they sing songs with like this beat. So
wow, I want to be like you when I grow up. Be like you when I grow up. You make it look so effortless, and I have to say, rightfully so, because you've been doing it for all your life. It would. Let me ask you. I watch you, right? Mm-hmm. And why were you playing?
Why?
I said you don't. You do not smile.
Oh, I don't know. I always have this serious face when I'm playing.
Was you concentrating?
I mean, no, it doesn't take much effort. I mean, this is, you know, something a little simple, but I guess, I don't know, my concentration face.
Because I'm just thinking that, you know, girl power, just doing her thing effortlessly, and like, you better don't try this at home because you'll get hurt, you know. And I'm saying, oh, gosh, smile. But I have another thought about watching you perform. Mm-hmm. Watch how your fingers are moving, how your hands are moving, how ambidextrous you are. You know, how it seems as though both hands are working equally hard. Are there exercises that you have to do for your fingers and your hands and your arms?
I do. The guitarists, they have like a finger tension grip.
Okay.
So that you can exercise each individual finger. So I usually practice with that, and I also do with my left hand to get the fingers a little stronger.
Is that
other than that, that's mostly what I do.
But is that routine? I mean, in terms of when you're exercising your fingers, you're talking about your fingers there, though.
Yes, the fingers. I don't do it routinely. It's usually sporadic if I feel like, you know, I'm not playing up to standard, like my standard, then I would just, you know, exercise a little bit, get it a little stronger, then I'll be able to get the flexibility in my fingers.
But you're talking about fingers, but what about the hands and what about the arms? Because I watched you play the dolak just now, and I'm thinking, you know, the way that you're holding your hands, I'm thinking, you know, it coming from your shoulders and all of that, I just thought that there might be some exercises that you have to do for your arms.
No, I don't do any exercises for the arms, but once you start playing and you feel the music, it just gives you that energy to be able to, you know, hold you in. Maybe that's why I don't smile.
No. And that's a very important point, because I am thinking it's energy. You're exerting energy. And that in itself, sometimes, you know, I mean, as a dancer, I know that sometimes when stamina is, when you're losing your stamina, it's really hard to smile sometimes, because that takes away some of the energy you feel like, you know, it takes away some of the energy from smiling. And you really have to monitor yourself. So I can see in some ways just concentrating on making sure that you're keeping your form and that your rhythm is tight and it's where it should be, that you won't even think about smiling.
And it helps with the timing too. Sometimes I'm like keeping the timing in my head, so I focus on that, and I don't smile. And sometimes I can't even talk while I'm playing.
So, okay, good point. You're keeping rhythm in your head. Is that throughout most of your performances?
Yeah,
Yes and no. Sometimes the rhythm, I follow the rhythm of the music, and if the music pulls me, I don't have to focus so much on the timing of it. Some things, if you play on something a little bit more classical, that is strategic on time, so I try not to you know, mess up on that. And especially if I'm playing for a poetry, the poetry goes in a certain meter, so I pay attention to that as well.
So I asked you earlier whether you write music. Mm-hmm. Do you ever have to read music for what you do?
No, I was taught East Indian music, so I read a little bit, but not enough to be able to read music and be able to play it back as like on scales and the Western notes.
So if you're in the group are performing and you're learning a song, how does that happen?
So I do what I call active listening. So I listen to it one time without playing anything. I listen to it a second time. I start clapping the timing in my hand. And eventually I figure out what tal or what beat would go with it and what variations I can put inside the song.
Now, as part of the group, are the other group members doing the same thing? How are they learning?
Most of the time, yes, they're doing the same thing.
Okay. So you must know what you're doing to be able to attempt this. This is what I'm hearing.
Yes. For me, most of the time, it's feeling. It's how I feel the song, where it's pulling me. Sometimes if I need to go faster or slower, depending on the song, depending on the melody. Also, the musician itself. If I'm accompanying a singer, I want to make sure that we have a mutual trust in between the two of us to be able to, you know, present the song properly.
So you work with singers. Do you work with dancers also?
Yes. So I did for a Kathak dance school, they did a Kathak presentation and they wanted live music. So I played tabla for them and they showed me, you know, the movements that they played. And I also listen. Everything is like ta, te, te, ta, ta, te, te, ta. So I would listen and kind of translate it into their footwork would go in with the beat.
Uh-huh. Yep. Oh, I'm just thinking of the great Philip McClintock, who was a very well-known Guyanese Indian dancer, an Afro-Guyanese who trained extensively in India, and he was our guru. At the National Dance Company of Ghana, and I mean, he was awesome. He was awesome. I remember one of my brothers saw him dancing for the first time. He said, "Oh, that man was spinning like a buck top." You know, every time I remember, you know, the late Philip McClintock, what my brother has said about him. So we've talked about your work, your journey as a musician, as a percussionist, as an instrumentalist, and you know, the rarity of seeing you as a female, especially as a female tabla player. If I'm not mistaken, I'm not sure I mentioned this earlier, you are one of the few female tabla players from the Caribbean region, so to speak. So I would call you one of the trendsetters. And I wonder, as a trendsetter, as a unique, being in that unique position, what are a couple challenges that you've experienced?
When I first started going to music school and I told, you know, other members of my community that I started playing tabla, some of the comments were, "Oh, okay, well, you know, why don't you sing or play the sitar or play harmonium?" And I would just simply answer, like, those don't interest me. That's not, you know, my passion. I had a passion for for tabla for as long as I could remember. And some people did try to discourage me to say, okay, you know, just play the harmonium or play the sitar, but it always called to me, the tabla always called to me, and that's when I just kept going. Tried to block out, you know, all negativity. And if something would bother me, I would tell my parents and they would say, just don't worry about it. Keep doing what you're doing.
Now, any one of those individuals who have discouraged you, have they come back and complimented you since?
Yes.
And what was it like?
It was good. You know, I'm glad that they see what I've become, and I'm sure, I mean, it's never been mentioned, but I'm sure that, you know, they were happy that I pursued and kept it going, because now they talk about it all the time. Not all the time, but whenever it comes up that, you know, oh, I have this person, she was a tabla player, she's a great tabla player, you know, you should listen to her or something like that.
Okay, so let me ask you. We just talked about a challenge. Well, there are a couple of benefits of being in the position as a trendsetter.
That's a good question. So I was scheduled to play tabla for a pundit at a mandir, and my dad dropped me off at the door and said, stay here, I'll come back for you. So because I can't carry the tabla myself, that was another challenge. The tabla was so heavy. I had to have my grandfathers come and take me to music school, bring me back home, or my dad, but somebody always had to carry the tabla for me. And to be quite honest, even this day, I don't carry my own tabla.
Ooh, I'm not going to say celebrity in the house.
No. It's just a matter of it's heavy. But so I was at the place and my dad dropped me off. He went to look for parking. So this older lady comes to me and she says, you know, what are you, because I'm a little girl standing in the sidewalk. She goes, you know, what are you doing? I said, oh, I'm just waiting for my dad. He went to look for parking. She saw the bag on the floor and she goes, you're the tabla player? And I said, yes. She goes, okay, come. And she pulls me in. She sits me down in a corner while I wait for my dad and I get milk and cookies.
How old were you?
I was about 7.
Okay. So
eight.
That was awesome, I guess, for a 7-year-old, right?
Oh, yeah, milk and cookies, sure.
Now, let's look at, now that you're older and you're embracing your confidence, you're embracing your passion for the music and the instrument, especially the tabla. What is a plus for you as a female tabla player?
I like getting feedback from other girls. One time I had played in a concert in upstate New York, and after I finished, I was playing along with my peers, some of my friends who were like either my age or like a year or two older. And basically it's just like, we're having fun, we're jamming on stage, even though it's a performance, the atmosphere that we created between ourselves is just very jovial. And you know, you don't think twice if you mess up, somebody else covers for you or something like that. So afterwards, when I was finished with the concert, a little girl and her mom came up to me and, you know, they were talking to me about how great it was. I think I was playing the electric drums as well as the tabla for the show. And, you know, they were just surprised that a female is doing all this. And the little girl, actually, she asked for my autograph.
Nice.
So I told her, I was like, you know, I'm not a celebrity, you know, and I still, you know, gave her a little autograph and stuff. And she's saying that, you know, she wants to also start playing the tabla. And I know a couple other girls who started playing the tabla. I'm not sure if it was because of me, but after I had you know, starting it, I've seen it become something a little bit more common in our community.
And I think what you're saying here is really critical, critical with respect to what this program is about. Because if you remember when I talked about the program in the beginning, I talk about the importance of culture being passed on and what you've just mentioned. And throughout our discussion here is how information about the talent and grooming you to become a tabla player as a female has been passed down, whether it is from the gurus, whether it is that you're passing on to this to other young girls. And I must also highlight the fact that you are still in your prime, you're a young lady, and you have so much more in front of you to accomplish. And we're talking about you doing this effortlessly because you've been doing it all your life, but there's so much more in you and I can't wait. But I want to ask you to play a little bit more for us and then we'll work on closing this off. Could you do that for us, please?
Sure, no problem.
Wow. Thank you much. You know, I just took a peek in the chat there and I saw Dudley on and Vernie saying, if you're passionate about anything, you unconsciously are in that mood. And she said, I can relate to Yash because I'm always choreographing in my head, coming up with different ideas, then I'll write it down. That was a beautiful fusion. So Vernie's talking about the pieces that you did. And Linda Griffith, who is the director of the National Dance, the National School of Dance in Guyana, she said, I'm loving this. I love to see women playing drums. As soon as I hear music, visions of new choreographies appear. All right, Linda, we're paying attention. So make sure you get in touch with Yash. And those are accomplished dancers, Guyanese dancers, who have weighed in on what they've heard. Yash, I have the million-dollar question for you right now. And that million-dollar question is, what would you say to young girls what would you say to parents who are hesitant to have their young daughters get involved in tabla playing?
I would tell them to support their child. If this is something that they want to pursue, give them that opportunity, because you never know where it's going to take you. I would have never dreamed that when I was 4 years old, sitting down, just knocking tabla in my house after the recording, that I would get this far. But I persevered. I went, went through all these challenges, jumped over the hurdles, and this is where I am today. And only after having this conversation with you, I realized how much I've actually done in, you know, in my life. And I really want them to be able to, you know, let their children shine in the passion that they have.
What would you say to young girls who are thinking that I am not, tabla playing is for girls. I want to just sing, or I want to just dance.
I wouldn't force anyone to if they're not interested in playing the tabla or any musical instrument, I wouldn't force you to it. I feel like if you want to play an instrument, you have to have the desire inside first. That is half the battle. Because I've seen people who the parents would tell them, okay, you have to go to music class and you have to learn to play this. And they do it and it's just, you can tell it's not for them, it's not in them. Whatever passion it is that you have in any type of the arts, just go for it and pursue it as much as you can, because you never know where it can take you.
But one of the things, especially for children, right, is peer pressure. Mm-hmm. And what if, and I'm just creating a scenario here, what if there's this young girl who really wants to play the tabla, but her friends are influential and she comes to it? What words of encouragement or advice would you say, that she would really love to learn to play the tabla, but because of what her friends are involved in, maybe singing and or dancing, and they're discouraging her, she doesn't want to stand out. What would you say to that young girl?
Fight through the peer pressure. If this is something that you want to do, I've also had friends who ask me the same question, why you don't play, you know, the sitar like us, or, you know, try to sing. I've actually tried to play harmonium. Not tried. I went to school to play harmonium for about a year. And after that, I gave up. It was not something that was pushing me. I wasn't drawn to it. And some people ask me, why you choose the tabla? I said, I didn't choose the tabla. The tabla chose me. You know, and I feel like peer pressure, you get a lot of that these days. And it's just, it's hard to fight, but the end is worth it. Yeah. The end result is worth it. So keep pushing, keep, you know, trying your best, doing what you have to do, and fight through the peer pressure, because it will be okay later, you know, later on.
I'm glad to hear that you acknowledge that you were pressured also by peers, because it's, I can see that. I really can see that, Yash, because it was a real unique thing for you to graduate from East Indian Music Academy as, you know, the first girl at the time when you graduated, and then really move through growing your talent along the way, fighting those hurdles, because you would have gone through those preteen years and teen years when your peers would have been playing other instruments that a girl is not usually seen playing, like tabla, and still have to fight through that. So mm-hmm. I'm glad that you acknowledged that there is some peer pressure that you have to face and overcome in playing the tabla. And look at you now. Look at you now. I am so excited to speak with you. I was so excited to speak with you today. I know I'm biased because I'm just one of your cheerleaders. I just love the fact that you are a trendsetter and you do this without any bashfulness. And I'm so proud of you and the work that you do, Yash. Really proud of you. So we're coming to the end of the show. And before closing, I would like to say thank you again, wholeheartedly. Thank you for coming on, Yash.
Thank you for having me.
I really am thrilled that you were able to come on. And for those of you who have been, who found the time today, I know there's a lot of things happening to join us. Thank you. And before I wind this up, I would like to remind you that the Ghana Cultural Association of New York, its folk festival season is continuing via the virtual platform of Zoom. We're actually going through our summer workshop series that began on July 1 and ends on August 6th this week. Our upcoming events are the Literary Hangin' Symposium on Saturday, August 22nd, the award ceremony on Wednesday, September 2nd, Come to My Kwekwe on Friday, September 4, and Family Fun Day on Sunday, September 6, all virtually done. Please visit GCA's Facebook page to get more information about our folk festival season. So as I say thank you to my guests today, Yash Sunarine, and to you, the viewers, for joining us on Arts, Culture, and Things in Between. I must acknowledge our technical engineer, Mr. Raul De Silva of RDE Pros. Raul, I sincerely thank you for your unselfish work in doing this program with me on Sundays. So I appreciate you very much. To all of you who've been supportive, thank you. I am hoping that you're able to join us next Sunday and bring a friend along. Arts, Culture, and Things in Between. Then my guest will be Salyu Soso, a musician who is an expert kora player. If you don't know what a kora is, please research it. And he's from Gambia. So on that note, I would like to say, have a very productive week. Have a safe week, please. Take care of yourselves, take care of your loved ones as we continue to spread the love. On that note, I say thank you. And Yash, thanks again.
No problem. You're welcome. Thank you.
And bye to you for now. Have a productive week. Thanks.